thank you, Amarda, so much for the introduction and also for inviting me. So I'm looking forward to meeting with many of you today. So today I want to talk a little bit about my worldview in terms of, and kind of globally about my research agenda and the research vision. And while we're going through that, I'll give you kind of a big picture overview and then a few examples of projects running in my lab in the past few years. All right, so I have synthesis for robots, guarantees and feedback for complex behaviors. So let me start kind of unpacking that. What do I mean by complex behaviors? For example, the DARPA Robotics Challenge. How many of you know what the DARPA Robotics Challenge was? Okay, so DARPA ran, people remembering. DARPA ran a few challenges that have to do with robotics. The first being the Grand Challenge, which was driving in a desert. The second one being the DARPA Urban Challenge that started this explosion of self-driving cars. So a lot of the early Google, the early Google ventures into self-driving cars came from people who won the competition in 2007. A couple years ago, in 2015, they had the DARPA Robotics Challenge. The idea there is, can we have a robot help in a disaster relief scenario? The idea here was, it was inspired by the Fukushima nuclear reactor disaster following the tsunami. And the challenge here was, have a robot do 8 tasks. The tasks were, drive a car, get out of the car, open a door, go through the door, well, that was part of the opening the door, cut out a hole in drywall, do some unknown manipulation task, close a valve, go over rough terrain, and walk upstairs. So this is an example of Team Keist, and do all that in under an hour. For every task you complete, you get one point. Whoever got the most points in the least amount of time, won. So this is Team Keist, they're the winners. This is clearly sped up, so I'm not gonna show how long it is, but it opened the door. There's some interesting design choices that the team made in terms, for example, putting wheels on the knees to facilitate motion in the environment. A lot of other teams had the Atlas, which was walking. We'll see that in a little bit. So now it picked up a drill. It's going to cut a hole through the drywall. But the objective was to make sure the whole black circle is cut out. So you can cut out kind of a little separately. It's doing the unknown manipulation task, which in this case was a plug-in, kind of an abstraction of a plug-in. So just gonna let it go. Here, because it's driving, it basically just plows through all the rubble, which was an interesting strategy, and then it walks upstairs. Does anybody know how long it took? Ballpark? So it had to be under an hour. So finish in under
59 seconds.
So it's about 44 minutes itself. So this was the team that did the best, the fastest. There were a few teams that got all 8 points, but in slower time. You can watch the So the reason I'm showing this is because this is what I mean by complex behaviors. So you can think about robotics, you can think about a lot of different types of behaviors, and there's a lot of work on motion planning and sorry, kind of being distracted. Good?
I think we're good.
We're good? Yeah, I'm gonna say it. This is a new, unusual experience for me because I've been recorded a few times and nobody ever stopped me in the middle saying, you know, we can't hear you, so. All right, complex behavior. So this is a behavior that is it's complex. It depends on the environment. For the manipulation task, you do different things depending on what you're trying to do. If something fails, you need to recover from that and so on. There's a really great blooper video for this, which I will show a very short piece of. But this is a very complicated task. What you don't see in this video, and what you don't see in the fact that it took 44 some minutes to complete this by the winner, is that it took a large team of very talented engineers to accomplish that. So I was part of a team, Team Vigor. We did not do quite as well. We got 3 points out of 8, so we were kind of middle of the pack in terms of success. And this is the team. I'm not in there, the picture, but this is my former student. And it took a team of 20 engineers 2 years to accomplish this task. So a lot of effort, a lot of expertise came into going from this
high-level task, this, you know, complete these eight missions, to actually a robot working in the workspace. Not only did it take 20 engineers 2 years to do that, roughly 2 years to do that, this is online. So this behavior was not fully autonomous for no team. All teams had operators sitting about 100 yards away with the Wi-Fi connection. And several of the things that enabled this task were done by human operators. More specifically, a lot of the perception work was done with people. So, for example, you had a valve that you want to close. So you get a point cloud, and the operators in our case, so this is our team, would kind of superimpose a model of that valve on the point cloud to make sure that the perception is working well. So there's a lot of kind of an interesting side effect here was DARPA was on purpose toning down the bandwidth, so making the connection less reliable. However, when we knew that this was going to happen, but what we didn't know was going to happen is even if the bandwidth was turned up all the way, everybody was standing. So here you're seeing the view from the stands. So there were like these large stadium stands, and everybody has their Wi-Fi or the Wi-Fi enabled device. So there was a lot of interference just from the crowd. So there was a lot of kind of so that was interesting. All right. So the point I'm trying to make here, and sorry this is a little bit longer than I expected, is it's a complex task. It took a long time to accomplish partially the task, and even that was not fully autonomous. Now what happens, the motivation here was for disaster relief. So now if I want to take this robot and change it to this disaster relief scenario, so this is Puerto Rico, a few weeks ago, how do I go from that, with that robot? I don't have 2 years and 20 engineers to deploy this robot in a new environment for a new task. So really, how should I be able to deploy complex tasks or complex robots in complex tasks in complex environments quickly? That is kind of the question that I'm interested in. So from that, I kind of go back to description of the things I'm interested in, my worldview. So formal synthesis for robotics, theory and tools for automatically transforming specifications into behaviors designs. So what I'd like to have is an ability to say, go help in Puerto Rico, or maybe slightly more detailed than that, and have a robot to deploy quickly, correctly, in a way that it can guarantee its behavior. That's what we're trying to do. So there's a bunch of things going on here. So again, let me unpack this a little bit. So what is a specification? What am I talking about when I say specification? So some of the work that we've been doing was literally going from natural language to a specification, from natural language to a robot controller. For example, put the blue block in the bin, right? So you can't, this is a Baxter. We ran this in collaboration with people at MIT and University of Rochester. Really, the underlying formalism that we care about or that we're using is logic. So this is temporal logic. If you've never seen these symbols before, that's totally fine. But the idea is to have an ability to capture in an unambiguous and formal way what the task should be. And once we have that baseline formalism, we can definitely come up with methods to go from natural language, from more kind of ambiguous, messy specifications to logical formalism and being able to provide feedback. And Jan and I collaborated on a project many years ago that started this kind of work. But I'm not going to be talking a lot about that. I'm happy to talk about that offline. I care about automatically transforming specifications for robots. So there are a few things I need to kind of consider when I say robots, and a few things when I say automatically. So underlying here is I need to make sure I have the right abstractions that allow me to go from a physical system, from an Atlas humanoid robot, or from a Kukiubot that's moving in infinite dimensional space, or the state space of the system is infinite dimensional, it's continuous, there are disturbances, my modeling is not the best, usually, but I still want to go be able to somehow abstract these systems into components that I can then compose and reason about. So there are some abstractions we thought about for the Atlas, for the DARPA Robotics Challenge. There are different abstractions that I'll talk about today in terms of motion and composition and things like that. I care about behavior and design. So I think I mentioned this before. If my task is to take a physical system, high dimensional, whatever, to go from point A to point B, the things that I'm talking about are not really relevant for that. Because there's a huge literature and definitely people in the audience who've worked on motion planning and optimized motion planning and high dimensional and very, very interesting and exciting techniques to do that. So that's not quite what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about here is how do I compose these eight tasks in a way that will create the robot's behavior? How do I compose, and I'll talk a little bit about this, modular robots that now can attach and reattach and change configuration based on the required task? So slightly higher level abstractions, more complex behaviors for these robots. And the thing I want to say is where this formal comes into play, and I have formal in quotation marks because we don't have a good definition of what formal synthesis is. So last year we had a doctoral seminar on formal synthesis where nobody could agree on the definition of formal synthesis. So I'm just going to leave it as that. But the fact that I have formal synthesis in here kind of implies that what I want is I want to somehow guarantee the behavior of the robot. Now, guaranteeing the behavior of the robot will always be with respect to something. I can't guarantee that the robot will never fail because a meteor can follow my robot and it will crash and then it fails, right? So I know this is somewhat of an extreme, but when I'm talking about guarantees, it's always with respect to something, with respect to a specification, with respect to a model, with respect to some uncertainty. I need to bound what I mean by guarantees. And there are many times I can't actually provide guarantees. So what I want to do, and this is becoming more and more interested in this, it's okay that I can't guarantee, but what I'd like to do is I'd like to provide feedback about when I cannot guarantee, or feedback about when I think the robot might fail. Because that is very, in robotics in general, you have the, you know, if you were an undergraduate designing a robot for a competition, and you're writing code for it to do something, and then it either does it or it does not do it. And when it does not do it, you debug. Right? And depending on your expertise, your experience, your common sense, you're able to do that better or worse. But you don't really, the robot is not coming back and telling you, you know what, these conditions happened and therefore this happened. Once we have a logical formalism underlying our synthesis approach, we can start reasoning about why I can't do things. And if I tie this logical formalism to my abstraction, to my physical system, then I can start talking about feedback about the physical system itself. And I'll give you one example for that in a bit. All right, so where do we live? So this is kind of where I live, kind of in this small little area here. Formal methods, the mathematical theory and tools that talk about system properties, system modeling, verification, synthesis, has some overlap with control and hybrid systems, which you tend to be more dealing with continuous systems, with systems that properties like stability and reachability. There's an overlap there. Robotics is starting to make more progress in there, and this is not centered on purpose, because there's more overlap, I would argue, that there's more overlap with robotics and control hybrid systems than there's formal methods. But really, what we're trying to do, and people in the community, not just me, are trying to push these circles closer together. So that's kind of an overview of where we are. So I want to give you, before I go into specific things that we've done in my group, we recently, again, shameless plug, wrote a review article about synthesis, me and a couple of colleagues. And this will give you kind of an overview. What do I mean by synthesis? What is the synthesis process? I keep saying synthesis, but I didn't actually define it. So the idea is, given a specification and given some robot model, sometimes I might be given an initial state, sometimes I might be given an environment model, a cost function. There are different techniques to be used. But ultimately, I always get a specification and a robot model. I run that through a synthesis algorithm, and either I get information back that the specification cannot be done or cannot be guaranteed, and sometimes I'll get feedback about why, or I will get a controller that then, when composed with a robot, creates the behavior that I wanted. Sometimes this is done in an iterative manner, so a lot of kind of work with within the sampling-based motion planning, you have to kind of iteratively go back and forth with between the synthesis and the lower level abstraction to see what's going on. Sometimes you have the environment, and this is where the reactive synthesis comes into play, so it's kind of a game-based. Given this the environment is doing this, I'm going to do that. But all these things are kind of optional, but this is kind of the view of synthesis in general, or the way we think about formal synthesis. So what are the different pieces there? So we have abstractions. We have a specification. And a lot of people, the main formalisms used for specifications are temporal logics or probabilistic temporal logics. So temporal logic is a logic that has temporal connectives. So I can say things about something will eventually be true, something is always true, something is true until something else becomes true. That it's captured by the logic. Probabilistic temporal logic, add probabilities on top of that. So the probability of this happening in the future is greater than 90%. Signal temporal logic, metric temporal logic, add some notion of continuous variables. So time is continuous, or state is continuous, and you're talking about predicates over states. Lately, we've been looking a little bit at SMT, satisfiability modular theories. So you have, it doesn't really matter. I'm not going to be talking about that a lot. The underlying things are things that we've been looking at in my group, and you know, some of them more recently and some less. So we have abstraction, kind of how am I modeling my system, my specification, what I want the system to do. And the final component is the synthesis algorithms themselves. And for that, we have, there are different approaches to do it. There's automata-based approaches. There are game-based approaches in which the environment is modeled as an adversary. And that's kind of what we've been doing in my group. This is the reactive synthesis. So assuming the environment can do all these different behaviors, can I find a controller that will guarantee the robot does the task? There are optimization-based techniques that are tied more to the metric temporal logic, signal temporal logic, when you have some notion of continuous. And you can think about robustness metrics that are now continuous. There's a lot of really nice work in that. OK, so that was an overview, slightly lengthy overview. Today, what I want to kind of give a little more information about just three of the projects that happened in my lab in the last few years. So I want to talk about two projects related more to the abstraction and kind of what the specification that come along with that. And a little bit talking about how we look at synthesis and what do we need to do with synthesis when we're talking about physical system operating in possibly unknown or unpredicted environments. So again, somewhat simplified, but those are the three projects under two categories in which we'll talk about. So I'm not talking about specifications. Again, our natural language work goes along more that the specification route. All right, so let me start talking about abstractions. So I'm going to start with this work. This was a former student who's now at Toyota Research Institute in Boston, Cambridge. Here's the idea. So this is a task. It's a very simple task. This is kind of to illustrate what we're trying to do. So here's my task. I have a robot. This is my, it's a Kuka U-bot. It has omnidirectional wheels, so it can move sideways. It's a pretty cool platform. And the task is going to be, every time you get a box here, the user is going to tell you either move it to the left or move it to the right. So green is yes, red is no. I'm assuming the user is not going to mess with me, and only one of them is going to be on, or exactly one of them is going to be on when I see a box. If I want to move to the right, it's going to drop it off to the right. If I want to move it to the left, it's going to drop it off. If I say move left, it's going to drop off left. Is it moving? OK. And the interesting thing here is we change the dynamics of the robot based on the part of the task. So when it's pushing when it's pushing the box, it cannot move sideways. It cannot move backwards. So modeling is a non-holonomic robot, even though it is holonomic. So I'm maintaining some constant velocity. I'm maintaining some radius of curvature. But when it's moving without the box, it can move in any direction it wants. So I have a lot less constraints on my dynamics. All right. So yeah, it's going to move back. So here's the problem that we created. This is I want to walk you through how we synthesize a controller for this. So this is the environment. It's just a model of the robot moving around. My abstraction is going to be my regions. So my a proposition, a building block in my specification is a region. So I have the blue region. This is rotated on the left. So this is the right. This is the left. This is the middle area, and so on. And my task is visit the loading area. When a box arrives, move it to the drop-off, to drop off left if left is requested. Otherwise, move it to drop off right. This is not the way we input the specification. So this is natural language, which we are not doing here. So we have this structured language, which is definitely not as nice as this, but at least it's not writing LTL. And what we get when we run the synthesis algorithm is we get the state machine. Very, very, very simple. So I start off, let's say I'm starting off here in the blue. I'm going to move to the middle. If drop off right is true, I'm going to move to the right. Otherwise, if drop off left is true, I'm going to move to the left. I'm going to go back to the middle, and I'm going to repeat. So it's a very simple state machine. Just kind of anticipating questions. Yes, I could absolutely write this by hand. And if it's the only thing I want the robot to do, we shouldn't be using synthesis. Okay? Arguably. There's some notion of removing some errors when going from specification to implementation, but if it's just one thing, there are other ways to do that. All right, so I got this discrete thing. I have this discrete state machine, but I want to move a robot that has different dynamics. So each transition here corresponds to a different dynamic for the robot and a different controller that will have to drive the robot. Now, there's some properties here. When I'm in this area, I want to make sure I'm going to apply a controller, a continuous controller, that will take me to this green area, to the middle. Okay, I don't want to go suddenly find myself in the red area. So I have to have some controllers that guarantee that. So we can do that. We can create these controllers, and this is based on work. So there are multiple approaches to do this. Specifically for this work, we're kind of building on top of some work from Russ Tedrick's group or Ani Majumdar's work at MIT. Ani is now at Princeton. So the idea here is you generate a sample trajectory, or you can generate a trajectory however way you want, that goes from one region to another, for example, from P to M. And what you do is you solve a convex optimization problem around it to create this invariant funnel. So this blue funnel, it's a projection from 3D space because we have x, y, and theta to 2D space, which is x, y here. And what I know about this, what I can prove about this funnel is if I start anywhere within this blue funnel, I will always stay in this blue funnel, and I will converge to the goal set, which is somewhere here. Okay, so I can do that. There, we know how to do that with prior work. Sometimes I might want to stay in a region. Actually, that's not quite what I wanted to say. So for here, I just have one transition to go from P to M. So I'm going to go, no matter what I do, no matter what the decision is, I'm going to go to the middle. Now I'm going to start executing, let's say I'm told to move to the right, I'm going to start executing the motion to the right. But then I might change my mind, or the user might change their mind and say, okay, you know what, actually not to the right, to the left. So then instead of completing this transition, I need to move to this transition. Because these transitions, as opposed to usual interpretation of automata, it's not instantaneous. So these are transitions that take time. So I want to move to the left. So to enable this kind of changing your mind, this is kind of the contribution of this paper, we create these additional controllers that allow you to go from the domain of one controller to the domain of another controller and basically change your mind. So this is kind of this green controller shows that I'm starting to move in a certain way, but now I can change my mind and find myself and create an invariant set that's contained within this region and allows me to move to a different region if needed. Okay, in this case, this green region is not great because it gets out of the boundary of the region, which I'm not allowing. So I want to maintain safety constraints, so I must stay within my boundary. So we can use control barrier functions, and which requires it's computationally more expensive, but we can still do it, and we can get these controllers. Now this is a sound but not complete algorithm, so I might not be able to find a controller even if one exists. But this is but if I find a controller under my modeling assumptions, it's guaranteed to be safe and allow me to compose things together. All right, great. So I just said that we can find controllers that could allow me to change my mind. So we call this reactive composability. So here's an example. So I'm changing my mind from right to left. Now, the robot ended up in the right. Okay. So what I just said of me being able to change my mind, clearly I wasn't quite accurate because it didn't change its mind. It moved on and it failed. It failed my task. It broke my guarantees because I wanted the robot to. Oh, I'm sorry. I wanted the robot to be in the left and end up in the right. What happened here? Why can I not? What broke? I guess you need the microphone. Never mind. I'll answer it. The microphone. So what happened here is that I changed my mind too late. So the robot was moving. There is no way for it can't stop and back up. with the box because it's pushing a box. If I was it was me holding the box, I'd stop, you know, a millimeter before before going into the right area. I'll be a little bit annoyed, but I would, you know, turn around and go to the other side and be able to complete my task correctly. But the dynamical constraints of the system did not allow me to do that. So where can I see that? I can see that. Granted, it's difficult to see it here. But what I can see is in this example, the controller that allows me to change my mind does not actually go all the way to the edge. So there's an area here in which I can no longer change my mind because I don't have any controller that will drive me back in. So if we have these different controllers that we can compose together, what we can do is we can actually analyze, given the task, given the dynamics, I can analyze areas, or I can refine my abstraction. I can break down my original region abstraction and create more regions, but now they have a slightly different meaning. So now, as long as I'm in the green, I can change my mind, that's fine. If I'm now on my way to yellow and I'm in pink, you can change your mind, that's fine, but I'm not willing to guarantee anything else. So it's not that I can't necessarily do it, but I cannot guarantee that I can do it. So I'm kind of weakening my guarantees because of my dynamic constraints. So this is what you'll see happening here. So by creating these controllers and creating the automata that we had before, we're basically enabling this composition. So here, I changed my mind right before it entered the pink region, and then just can compose this inward-facing funnel and go back and complete the task. So that's the idea. So in this work, what we did was we go back and forth between the abstraction, the dynamics, and the task, and we both kind of formalized the notion of reactive composability, the ability to change. So the idea of composing funnels for controllers is a while ago, right? So there's work from, I think, the 80s or 90s that showed these kind of funnels or composition of controllers by having the file set of one controller be in the domain of the other controller, and then you compose them. Here the notion is I need to be able to change my mind in the middle. So I have these extra controllers that allow me to do that. Once we have those, we can automatically refine the abstraction to say, in this case, we can't do it. And the other thing is here we can provide feedback, and this is not feedback about can I do the task logically? Logically, this task is very simple. Go right or go left. There's not a lot of, there are no logical inconsistencies here. The problem that comes up here is the fact that the dynamics and my task, there's some mismatch. And we were able to provide feedback for that. All right, so that was a little bit on being able to go from the dynamics. And this is kind of, we were talking about this today. So my research is very much interdisciplinary. So I'm an electrical engineer by training. I have CS students. I have MECI students. But I'm sitting in a MECI department. So kind of gravitating a little bit more towards the physical and the dynamics, and which is interesting because where you end up kind of changes the course of your research. So I like it. It's an interesting observation. All right. What happens if I have slightly more unique robotic platforms? So the Kuka U-Bot is a mobile manipulator. There's a bunch of those out there. We're not using the manipulator, so really it's just a mobile platform. You can buy things very cheaply for many different types of robots. In this case, this is a collaboration with Mark Campbell at Cornell and Mark Kiem at Penn, at University of Pennsylvania. Here we have modular robots. So what's the idea here? These are robots. Each one of these white cubes is a 4-degree of freedom robot. So it has two wheels. It has a pan actuator, and it has a tilt actuator. So it has a controlled hinge in the middle. And each one of these faces, you can kind of see there are 8 magnets. And these are electropermanent magnets, so you can turn them on and off. So the idea of these modular robots is each one robot has mobility on its own, but it can't do a lot. What we want to do is we want to figure out how do we do high-level complex behaviors with modular robots, where now we control motion, action, but also configuration. So we're increasing the space of our controllers and our abstractions or atomic behaviors to include configuration as well. So let me show you kind of a little bit, a few things of that. So this is the, yeah, I should, probably should have spoken over this. This is a S'mores EP, electropermanent magnets. This is developed at Penn. Tarek, who's on the job market this year, is the main, he's one, the grad student who is the main developer of this hardware platform. And what we did was we said, okay, we don't quite know how to, oh, it's not that we don't quite know. The way that our approach to this is going to be, we are going to develop a library of configuration gates. And the way we're going to develop these is by creating a simulator that allows UPenn undergrads paid with donuts to design a whole bunch of different configuration gates. And we know that UPenn undergrads like donuts, the fancy donuts. So we had undergrads develop the using a basically a game. So if, this is based on Unity. Design different configuration gates that then we can compose to create higher level behaviors. So this is an example of, in the simulator, this is the example of the actual robot composed. So this is, it has different, it's one configuration that has multiple gates. So some of the gates are, it's a Hanami gate, it can go up and down, it can lift things. You'll see it doing it in a second. And what we did in collaboration also with Mark Campbell at Cornell is we had the robot perform a high-level behavior fully autonomously in an unknown environment. So this is the environment in which it's moving. This is a picture of the environment that we created. The robot has no information about the environment starting out. The only thing it knows there are certain types of environments it might see. So it can see like a tunnel, it can see a ledge, it can see flat. We have the high-level task is, again, it's somewhat simple because the what we wanted to show here is the versatility of this kind of robot. So we have the task is look for pink and green objects. So whoever is doing vision, I am totally embarrassed to say that we're doing pink and green blobs because that is what we're doing here. Even though we have we could do nicer things with other people's work. So there's pink and green objects. We want the robot to find green and pink objects and bring them to the drop-off zone. This is the drop-off zone. You can't see it here. You'll see it in a second. It's denoted by a blue square. So blue, pink, and green.
So the environment is changing?
The environment is not. So the question was, is the environment changing? The environment is not changing, but it's unknown. So it's static, but unknown in this case. We'll get back to that because it's an interesting question. It comes up, okay, so here's what we do. It does not know anything about this. The robot is composed of modules, so there's five modules here. It has a sensor module attached to it, so it has an RGBD camera on it, and it has a webcam pointing down, which you'll see in a second that's not what I wanted to do. So this is the way it's moving. You can see, so we're doing off-the-shelf visual SLAM algorithms. So this is based on Ross. It's building the map as it's going. Here it found the drop-off zone, just the blue blob in the middle. It's looking for pink objects. It detected a pink object right there. So it's going to go closer to that. And what it realized it's in this kind of tunnel environment. So we're defining a few characteristics of the environment. And it realizes that with this configuration, this is a fully autonomous, it cannot reach the pink object. So what it's doing, it's deciding to move to a different configuration that does allow it to create, to get that object. And the way it's reconfiguring, again, fully autonomously, is using the webcam. You'll see in a second the view from the webcam. So this is the webcam. This is choose an advertising times 8. So this is sped up. And the way we're doing, the magnets are very sensitive to misalignment. So you get a lot of, the force really drops when it's slightly misaligned. So we sometimes turn around a lot of times just to reduce uncertainty in pose. It got the object, so it's magnetic. And now it can't turn in this configuration. So it can't do motion in the environment with this. So what we're doing is reconfiguring back to the kind of car behavior. And we have to make sure that it's, we're on purpose pushing it a little bit more to make sure that it's that we won't have misalignments in there. It's gonna grab the pink object. I just want to show you kind of. Now it still has the map, so it knows where the drop-off zone is. So it was building this 3D map. It's gonna verify that it's there, and then it's gonna go drop it off. So now it so the idea here is it had to change configuration, even though it's an expensive operation, to be able to accomplish this task. And again, this is done fully autonomously. So this is great. We send this this paper out. It got rejected, and the reason for that, and you know, totally in a totally fair, it was a very constructive review and all that, because we showed one task, and when we show one task with this kind of synthesis approach, it is not convincing because modular robots, people have done amazing demos with them. So the idea that I can do this demo, even though it's fully autonomous and it has perception, which has not been done in the past, you know, fully autonomous with the perception has not been done in the past, but really to show the synthesis aspect of this, you need to show multiple different tasks, okay? So then we showed multiple different tasks. So this is under review now, so I don't know if it's gonna actually is it running? Yes, so that one's running, is the other one running? I'm going to run both of them. These two have the exact same task. The high-level behavior is exactly the same. It's find a pink area and drop off whatever you're carrying on that pink area. The difference is the environments are different. So since the environments are different, the configurations and gates have to be different. So one of them is climbing a stair and dropping that off. The other one found out that it has to put something on top. This is the stamp we're putting in, so we're kind of the task is send something from Penn to Cornell, a circuit board. So then we configure there. Here, it needs to reach something up above. So it's the same configuration as before. It's the same exact task, different environment, different set of required configurations and gates. Same as we had before. It's reassembling into this proboscis configuration. And it needs to reach up high. So what it's going to do, hopefully I'm not going to touch anything right now. I just like I like that motion, so I'm going to show that. So in the top, it kind of it dropped off two of these wheels, and it kind of did this kind of snake motion to get up the stairs. Here, I like that. And then it gets up, it's able to reach up high with that. Okay. So a question I get asked, so in this case, all these behaviors were manually designed, again, by some talented undergraduate and some very talented PhD students who wanted to get this done. We have been toying a little bit with using, for example, genetic algorithms or other things like that to develop these configuration gates. So we have done some work on that. It kind of, you know, we didn't pursue that line, but the idea is these configurations and gates, this library, can be populated by many, many different things, and really what we focused about was the compositionality here and the connection to the environment. So that's kind of, the main contribution here is looking at the abstraction of not just motion or regions in the workspace, but configuration gate environment. This is fully perception informed, so the composition is based on the perception itself, and we were able to provide a different type of feedback here. So the feedback here is, I'm going to generate my state machine, and I'm going to look, the state machine, I'm going to execute it, I'm going to go back to my library and query it to see if I have the right configuration gates, they have the right properties. If I see that something does not exist, I can go back to the user and say, you know what, putting something four modules high, I don't have anything. Can you create a new configuration gate? And the things we're toying with now, and this is a student who's going to be graduating in a month or so. So the last thing he's looking at is, can we parameterize these configuration gates such that we can, instead of having a specific manually designed configuration gate, have some parameter that can then be employed with a motion planner or with some other planner that allows us to compose it, create kind of a richer set of configuration gates. That's the idea with that. The final thing I want to talk about, so those were abstractions. Again, these are two different types of abstractions. One's when I have to be informed by the dynamics. The other, when it's just it's a weird robot, right? It's a cool, weird robot that we need to think about how to create high-level behaviors with. For the synthesis itself, I want to talk a little bit about the work here. So we've been using a lot of results from formalisms community, from reactive synthesis, on generating controllers using a game-based synthesis. So let me motivate this a little bit. So this is a short clip from the blooper reel from the DARPA Robotics Challenge. If you have not seen this, I highly suggest you see it. It is amusing. I'm not running the whole thing here, but it's very amusing. But I wanted to show you kind of what happened here. And there are multiple different reasons for failure. And there were a lot of failures, and we failed, so somewhat failed. Let me not be that negative. We still got a few points. But there are a lot of different reasons, mechanical, communication, blah, blah, blah. Here's an interesting failure case. So here the task is open the valve. All right, so why did it fail? I guess again, you can't, I'm sorry, yes. Okay, let me answer that again. You're fine. So why did it fail? It thought it was grasping the valve. It was not actually grasping the valve. It applied force, and the reaction wasn't great. So what happened here is that the environment was not as expected. The environment was supposed to be there, and it wasn't actually there. So that is something that is very typical for robotics, right? We have sensing, we have perception, we have noise in the perception, it's a hard problem, especially when you have these very unstructured environments. And even though this is a red tube, and I don't know what happened in this case because I don't know I don't know that team. I don't know if someone put some operator just put the template of the valve in the wrong place. I'm not quite sure what happened there, but clearly that was not the intended result, right? So the question is, what should I do when the environment does not satisfy my assumptions? Okay, what happens when the environment makes me fail or is not as I expect it to be? All right, so that's the question. Keep that in mind. Let me take a slight tangent. And as I mentioned before, that synthesis, there are different types of flavors of synthesis algorithms. One of them is game-based synthesis algorithms, which is based on mu calculus games. And this is the mu calculus formula, in case it's pretty, so I put it up, but I'm not going to talk about that a lot. But the thing you want to notice is for LTL game-based synthesis, the specification is always of this form. So we have phi e, which is a formula describing assumptions about the environment, implies phi s, which is the requirements on the robot. Now, these have internal structure as well. So this is a specific, there are reasons for that, for tractability and so. But this is an implication. So an implication is true if this side, if the right-hand side is true, or if the left-hand side is false. So really, by design, we are generating controllers that are winning if the environment violates the assumptions, just by definition. Right? So if my environment violated my assumptions, the valve was not actually there, then the robot can do whatever it wants. It's by definition winning. OK, but that's not what we want. We don't want to win because the environment is doing something illegal. What we want to be robust to environment doing things we didn't expect. So that's work from my student, Kat Wong, who's also graduating probably this year, hopefully. And the idea here, we're calling this environment failures, but it's not really failures. It's unmodeled behaviors. So we either made an assumption, we made an assumption that when physically executing, the environment actually does not satisfy. So what should we do? Should we just fail? So in the general, the kind of the reactive game-based synthesis, the robot will basically fail. What we wanted to do here is we wanted to add robustness to these kinds of unexpected behaviors. So what do? We do runtime monitoring over phi e. So it's fairly straightforward. You have a formula representing your assumption on phi e. You create a monitor that monitors that. And of course, it can only monitor. So when we think about specifications, there are two types. There's safety, things that always have to hold. And there's liveness, things that eventually have to hold. So liveness, you can't really monitor because it's an infinite, because it could always eventually happen. But safety, you can monitor. So we can monitor safeties. So we can detect when the environment is violating our assumptions. The other thing we can do is we can add transitions, kind of enforced transitions, that make the system, make the robots still able to do something, so still remain safe and have a possibility of accomplishing its goals, even if the environment is violating the assumptions. So as long as the assumption violation is transient, we're able to maintain all our guarantees. And also what we are able to do is we can automatically rewrite phi e. Now, when we were writing this paper, so let me give you an example, and then I'll come back to the rewriting of phi. So in this case, what you'll see is, again, it's a very fairly simple task. This robot's going to pick something up here. You'll see a cat we'll see our hair. Picking something up here, and it needs to drop it off here. We're assuming there's a door here, and we're assuming the door is always open. So I am modeling a door, but I'm assuming it's always open. All right, so let's see what happens. So starting to go through the door. It's walking walk, that's cat. It's turning around. There's a door. All right, the problem when there's a door, let me just pause this for a second. When there's a door, my assumption of the door being always open is no longer valid. So what I can do, I can weaken my assumptions by saying, you told me the environment is always open, but I just saw it closed, so let's assume the environment can always keep, the door can always be closed as well. Or rather saying, always my door is either open or closed, right? So if my door is either open or closed, what I'm doing is I'm weakening my assumptions, so I can automatically rewrite phi e. So originally we called it, we were toying with the idea of calling it learning, but this is not learning. So, and I don't want to, learning has so much, meaning associated with it. And this is definitely not learning. What we're doing really is we're just allowing more environment behaviors. So we're weakening the assumptions. Okay, so that's, so we're calling it environment characterization. So in this case, I can rewrite my specification to say the door is always open or closed, right? Now, if that's my assumption, I can no longer guarantee my task. And the reason for that is the door can be closed forever. There's nothing preventing the door from being closed forever. So now I can no longer do my task. I can no longer guarantee that I'll be able to satisfy my task. So then we do, and what you saw kind of showing up kind of this dialog box, is we can go back to the user and say, we can't do this because the door might be closed, may always be closed. And then the user can add an assumption, aliveness assumption, yeah, but the door will eventually be open. Once we have that assumption, I'm gonna run this quite quickly again. Once we have that aliveness assumption, which we cannot detect by looking at the environment, right? So alivenesses are things that you can't, in a finite duration, you can't really figure out. So here we say you can't see it, but it says infinitely often door open. So I'm assuming eventually it's going to be open. In that case, we're totally good, because if eventually it's going to be open, then I can complete my task. So the robot is just going to wait until the door opens, and it continues its task. So we can generalize that. So here we say that basically there's the robot, and there's the environment that is fully uncontrolled. So the robot has no say about the environment. It just needs to react and needs to be able to behave correctly with respect to it. We can generalize that to saying the environment might be friendly. I might be able to reason with my environment. And that situation is a multi-robot situation. So in this case, the setup here is we have two robots. Each one of them has their own specification, their own task, doing their own thing. But they're moving around in a shared environment. And each robot knows where the other robot is, or can detect when it's one region away. But the assumption is the other robot will not be in my way. It will not be in the region I'm trying to go to. And the task here, again, very simple. Orange wants to go to the orange flag. Blue wants to go to the blue flag. And you can see that this is possible. So what happens here is my assumption about my other robot is going to be violated. Actually, let me run it for a second. So it's a conflict because they were both trying to go to the same area. And I think it's not running again. So there was a conflict, but they resolved it. So how do they resolve it here? What happened here is whenever they detect conflict, one robot provides part of its own specification to the other robot. And then the other robot, if possible, incorporates that specification into their own specification. And then if it's consistent with their own behavior, that's fine. They just execute, they continue execution and moving on. So in this case, if orange wanted to, was communicating with blue, blue had nothing to do. It can't possibly get out of the way without going through orange. So it wouldn't be able to change its own specification. But blue communicating with orange was able to give orange their specification. And orange just got out of the way. But what you saw is that it went here, and then it started walking. So blue came in here, orange went all the way around and went back here. So clearly not optimal. This is not the best thing to do. But it still resolved the situation fully autonomously. All right, so for unexpected environment behaviors, we can think about enriching the synthesized controller, with transitions that are not great, but allow us to recover from temporary assumption violations. We weaken the assumptions about the environment, and as long as we're still OK, great. We can do autonomous negotiation between the two robots. And again, we provide feedback. The feedback here would be if both robots or if the environment assumptions can no longer guarantee robot behavior, we can say, you know what, this is the problem. This is why we can't do this. All right, so this kind of a recap of where I started and kind of where I was going with this. You can see that feedback is becoming kind of an important aspect, and feedback not necessarily in how we communicate it, but what type of information we're able to gather about success of a possible robot behavior, and the guarantees and with respect to specification, with respect to abstraction, with respect to model. So my collage, this is me with different lengths of hair and different students. So this is oldest to the newest, and funding sources. And thank you very much for your attention.